Have you heard there's an eclipse coming up? A total solar eclipse will be visible over this part of the United States on April 8th, and we know it'll be the last one we can see in North America until the mid-2040s. But can you imagine what it would have been like for people a couple thousand years ago when things like this happened? It must have been terrifying to be hanging out and just see the sun go out with no warning. Except it wasn't, because humans have been predicting eclipses since the 7th century BCE. As it turns out, our ancestors figured out how to do that without calculators or even telescopes, and here's how. If you need a refresher, an eclipse is when a celestial body blocks the light of another celestial body. So for instance, a lunar eclipse is when the Earth passes right between the sun and moon, which blocks the sunlight from bouncing off the moon and causes the moon to go dark. While lunar eclipses are relatively common, total solar eclipses are rarer. For these to occur, the moon has to be the monkey in the middle and block the sun from an observer's viewpoint on Earth. You can imagine that the first couple of times that this happened where people could see it, those people would want to understand why. And the story of figuring out that why begins roughly 2600 years ago in the Mesopotamian city-state called Babylon. The full history of the ancient Babylonians is vast and spans over a millennium. But for our purposes today, the main thing to know is that they were really interested in the study of astronomy. Records from early Babylon in the form of clay tablets show how obsessed they were with the stars. For instance, they documented the movement of constellations that served as the origin of what we know today as the zodiac. And they were the first group of people we have records of to make mathematical predictions of celestial events. Their ability to track the movements of the sun and moon let them develop a sophisticated calendar. Like, some of those ancient clay tablets are the earliest recorded evidence we have of people making mathematical predictions of celestial bodies' movements ever. And for predicting eclipses, they worked out a complicated system called Saros cycles that are still used today when referring to eclipses. A Saros cycle is a period of 223 synodic months. A synodic month is the period of time it takes the moon to complete one cycle. So for example, from one new moon to the next. The moon's cycle doesn't divide evenly into solar days, so a synodic month is roughly 29 days, 12 hours, 44 minutes, and 3 seconds. About 29 and a half days. And the 223 synodic months that make up one Saros cycle translates to just over 18 years. Fortunately for us, the ancient Babylonians showed us exactly how they figured this out, too. A clay tablet called BM45861 has all the details of how they calculated the Saros cycles. The Babylonians observed that once you saw an eclipse, 223 synodic months later, the moon would have returned to the same place relative to the sun and the Earth, and you could expect to see another eclipse. The geometry of how the celestial bodies are all moving means that the alignment only lasts for roughly between 1200 and 1500 years, which is obviously a long time to us, but it's the blink of an eye in terms of space. But even though they do repeat, none of the Saros cycles last forever. And yes, that is plural. There's more than one Saros cycle, and multiple cycles are always happening at the same time because there's more than just one way to line up the sun and moon and Earth that causes an eclipse. NASA has records of 180 total Saros cycles, which includes ones that have ended a long time ago and their predictions of ones that haven't even started yet. Having this many cycles makes sense because we don't only see eclipses every 18 years. In North America, our last solar eclipse was in 2017, and that one was part of cycle 145. Meanwhile, the 2024 eclipse will be part of cycle 139. The period of 18 years is when the next eclipse sharing that same celestial geometry is going to occur, not just the next eclipse at all. And eclipses in one Saros cycle aren't visible from that exact same spot 18 years later. The path of totality, aka where you get the best view, shifts about 120 degrees west for each eclipse in the series. Why? Because the Saros cycle is 18 years, 11 days, and 8 hours long. So the part of the planet experiencing daylight, and thus facing the sun, changes with each eclipse in that series. So yeah, this is pretty complicated, which makes it even more impressive that the Babylonians figured it all out. Early astronomers were so good at recording their data that we have evidence of an eclipse that occurred around 1223 BCE from the region now located in modern Syria. Unfortunately, we don't know for sure when it happened because translating dates from the ancient Syrian calendar into the modern Gregorian one is difficult. But even with that fuzziness, we're talking about something almost 3,000 years ago. And the really interesting thing is that historians think that the solar eclipses may not have been all that important to the Babylonians, at least not at first. We think that the Babylonian scholars tracked lunar eclipses first because those occur way more often than solar eclipses. But the thing is, once you figure out the math for lunar eclipses, you can apply it to the solar eclipses too. So what did the Babylonians do with their eclipse predicting powers? Because they probably weren't selling merch, but more on that later. We have evidence that people in lots of societies viewed the eclipses as bad omens, which, I mean, I get it. And eclipses of either variety were supposed to be particularly bad luck for the king, at least to the Mesopotamian descendants of the Babylonians. So in order to protect their monarch, they would appoint a substitute decoy king to serve during the hours of the eclipse. This way, the bad luck was believed to fall on the substitute instead of the real guy. They'd even assign the fake king a fake queen, too. And what do you do with a decoy king after the sun is back on? Well, you sacrifice him and his fake queen, too. So those two might not have been all that thrilled to know when an eclipse was coming, even if everyone else was. So anyway, it's clear that we've been curious about eclipses for a long time, and we owe a lot of our progress in astronomy to the ancient Babylonians who started us off, which is something I am grateful for, even if those sacrificed decoy royals probably didn't feel the same way. If this episode got you hyped for the eclipse in April, you should know that in order to look right at it, you're gonna need some protective eyewear. And while you're at it, why not pair your new specs with our awesome Path of Totality band style t-shirt? Celebrate this stellar solar phenomenon in style, baby. Links to everything down below. Happy eclipse watching, everybody.